Name the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Welcome to episode 13 of the whole Bible series, where we study the Bible from the book of Genesis till the book of Revelation. Today we're going to talk about Jacob, his relationship with his family, and his uncle Laban. So let's get started. Jacob, man of God. So let's review the story of birth of Jacob and his brother Esau. Isaac married Rebekah at age 40 and spent 20 years in marriage without kids. And as a good spiritual person, Isaac went to pray to God, asking for sons. And God blessed him by two sons in one time. So Rebekah got pregnant with twins, and they fought in her belly. Now again, Rebekah went to God, asking him, why am I suffering so much in this pregnancy? And this gives us a good example of a holy family. They resort to prayer when they are faced with issues or problem in their life. So God responded to Rebekah and said, two nations are in your womb. Two people shall be separated from your body. One people shall be stronger than the other, and the older shall serve the younger. The older son was named Esau, and the younger was named Jacob. The two boys grow together. However, the parents show unequal love to both of them, and that will result in unequal love between the brothers themselves. So Isaac loved Esau more than Jacob because Esau was a man of hunting. He went outside and caught game, while Rebekah loved Jacob since he was a shepherd man, spent most of the time next to her, learning from her ways of cooking. And that resulted in an unfair relationship between the two brothers. At one time, Esau came back from hunting, thirsty and hungry and tired, and found Jacob cooking some stew and asked him to give him some of the food. However, Jacob tricked his brother and asked him to make a deal, a trade deal. Sell me your birthright and I'll give you some of my stew. And here I have to compare between Jacob and Father Abraham. Father Abraham was a very noble and honorable man. When we saw three foreign guests coming toward him, he went out to them, washed their feet, and offered them a great meal. While he, Jacob, find his only brother hungry and thirsty, and he tried to take advantage of him. However, on the other hand, Esau didn't have any spiritual inspiration. All what he cared about is just food and how to fill his stomach, so he didn't really care much about the birthright. So the deal was done. Esau sold his birthright by stew. Then later on, when Isaac got older, and when he blessed his older son Esau, he called him, asked him to go hunt and get him some food so he can bless him. However, Rebekah heard that, and she favored Jacob, and because of that, she wanted Jacob to take the blessing, not Esau. So she made the plan, prepared the food, got sheepskin, and covered Jacob's arm. And Jacob went inside the tent to meet his father Isaac. He lied to him and pretend to be Esau. And it ended up, as we all know the story, that Isaac blessed Jacob and he gave him two blessings, blessing from earth and blessing from heaven. He told him, may God give you dew of the heaven, of the fatness of the earth, and plenty of grain and wine. Let people serve you and nation bow down to you, and let your mother's son bow down to you. This was the earthly blessing. The heavenly blessing said, cursed be everyone who curse you, and blessed be those who bless you. Genesis 27. Later on, Esau came asking for a blessing. However, Isaac told him, I already gave your brother the blessing and you have nothing left. And that got Esau so mad and he planned for revenge. And Esau started talking about killing his brother Jacob. Rebekah, out of her love to Jacob, asked him to flee to her brother Laban and stay with him for a few days until Esau's anger turned away. And she told Isaac that since Esau married to two of the local women and I don't like him, I wish my son Jacob go back to his uncle Laban and marry some of his daughters. And Isaac called Jacob a second time and blessed him again and sent him away. Actually, Rebekah didn't think that Jacob will spend so much time with his uncle. He thought he was going to spend a few months, maybe a year or so, and come back. However, Jacob spent 20 years with his uncle Laban. In those 20 years, he got 12 sons and one girl, and never have a chance again to meet his mom. And that was God's punishment for her because she lied to her husband, Isaac. On his way to his uncle, he was very afraid and tired, scared. He lay down on a rock and God appeared to him. And this was the first time God appeared to Jacob. In Genesis 28, the story tells you that God appeared to him saying, I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land in which you lie, I will give to you and your descendant. Also your descendant shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. And in you and in your seed, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. This is very similar to the blessing that God gave to his grandfather Abraham and to Isaac, that he will have so many abundant descendants like the dust on the sand, and he'll have so many blessings, and in his seed, in one person that will come in his seed, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And again, this verse refers to the person of Jesus Christ. Not only that, but God gave him a blessing of protection. And this is a very great example of godly protection. He told him, behold, I am with you and I will keep you wherever you go. And I will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done that I have spoken to you. Genesis 28, verse 15. This is a great verse. I hope we all remind ourselves every day when we leave our home that God be with us, will keep us and return us back to our homes. So Jacob wake up from these great dreams and he asked God, if you just give me food to eat and clothes to wear, I'll make three promises to you. First, he promised to worship God all his life and no other gods. Second, he promised to give tenths of all his earnings to God. Third, he erected a pillar of a stone and poured oil on it. And he called this place Bethel, which means house of the Lord. Until today, we still use the same example as Jacob. When we consecrate altars, we pour oil in them with holy prayers. Then Jacob went to his uncle Laban, and his uncle has two daughters. The older is Leah and the younger one is Rachel. And Rachel was her turn to take the sheep to be watered. So they went to the well, and as a custom this time there was a strong and big stone on the well. Jacob removed the stone and fed all the sheep. He introduced himself to Rachel and they both hugged one another. He took him to her father Laban and he spent one whole month with him as a guest. Then Laban told him, tell me what's your wage? What should I pay you? Because you're going to work with me here. And because Jacob loved Rachel so much, he asked him to marry her. So Jacob offered to serve him 7 years for Rachel. And the Bible says this seemed only a few days to him because of the love he had for her. He's going to spend 7 years working as a slave just to get married to Rachel. There is some important spiritual meditation I would like to mention here. First, he met his wife at the well of water. And as you know, the water is always a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And this is a good place where the husband and wife meet together around the Holy Spirit. And when he served her 7 years, and they seemed to be very few days to him because of so much love he had for her, that reminded you by Jesus Christ, when he came to the earth, he took all the suffering, the beating, the crucifixion, and they seemed to him very little in his eye just for the sake of our salvation. After 7 years, it's come time to marriage. Laban deceived him by giving him the older daughter, Leah. And Leah was not as pretty as Rachel. However, Jacob got angry and asked her to marry Rachel. And he said, okay, if you want to marry her, serve me another 7 years to get the right to marry Rachel. And he served his uncle 14 years. to get married to Leah and Rachel. By the way, the word Rachel means sheep, while Leah means weak. And that was actually all within God's plan. God allowed Laban to fool Jacob because he knew that Rachel will not long live and she only going to give him two sons. However, in God's plan, that Jacob should grow and multiply and have 12 sons. So Leah by himself, although wasn't intentionally in his plan, he was a big source of blessing to him. Leah gave birth to six boys. Six boys, half of the 12 tribes are born by Leah, while only two being born by Rachel. The first son is Reuben, the second one is Simon, the third one is Levi, and the fourth one was Judas. And you notice that Levi came first, and from Levi came the priesthood, then the fourth son Judah, and from Judah came Jesus Christ. Then God blessed him by more kids. And the custom of this day, every girl will married will have also a servant or a maid. So Leah made, her name is Zilpah, she delivered two boys for him, Gad and Asher. While Bilha, Rachel made, delivered two boys, Dan and Nathaniel. Then finally, Rachel delivered two boys, Joseph and Benjamin. And at the end, Leah delivered a girl, Dinah, which means judgment or revenge. So in total, he got 12 boys. They became the 12 tribes of Israel and one girl. So let's look at the names of the 12 tribes and their meaning. Reuben means seeing a son. This was the first son that Leah got. Simon means the Lord heard my prayer. Levi means join in harmony, because she showed when she had three kids that Jacob would attach her in harmony. Judah means praise or thanksgiving. Dan means God is my judge. Naphtali means wrestle or my struggle. Gad means luck or fortunate. Asher means happy. Issachar means reward or wage. Zebulun means to dwell together. Dina means judgment. Joseph means he will add, because Rachel thought God will give her another son, so you call him Joseph. And Benjamin, it's called son of my right hand or son of power. So those are the 12 tribes of Jacob or the 12 tribes of Israel. Of course, Jacob got so angry that his uncle Laban fooled him by giving him Leah, not Rachel. So he started to deceive him in the way they work. So he made a plan that to make all the good, speckled and streaked sheep to him, and while all the weak sheep and animals go to Laban. So it happened when the animals get thirsty and time of pregnancy that he picked the strong and speckled and straight sheep and put bars from tree before them. So when they drank water, the new generation became his own share. While Laban realized the trick, but he really couldn't understand how come Jacob getting many stronger sheep and animals while his share of animal getting weaker and poorer and weaker. 6 years later, Jacob got richer and Laban got poorer. And this basically was the blessing of God. God felt Laban deceived Jacob and he worked with Jacob to get a blessing from him. Then the second time God talked to Jacob and he asked him to go back to his father Isaac. Jacob started to fear his cousin and his uncle. He felt they came jealous of him. They might kill him and take the girls and their sons back. So God appeared to him and said, return to the land of your father, to your family, and I will be with you. I am the God of Bethel, where you anointed the pillar and where you made a vow to me. Now arise, get out of this land and return to the land of your family. So Jacob took his entire family and went back to his father. Of course, he didn't tell Laban or his sons. He just went by night. I would like here to talk a little bit about the reaction of Leah and Rachel toward their father. As the Bible explained to us here in Genesis 31, then Rachel and Leah answered and said to him, if there is still any portion or inheritance for us in our father's house, are we not considered stranger by him? For he has sold us and also completely consumed our money. This statement indicates to us that they got so mad at their father. They felt their father treated them as some sort of a commodity. He sold them and takes the money to his own house. So they were completely with Jacob against their father. They further elucidate and called, "For all the riches and which God has taken from our father are really ours and our children." So now they realize that the husband Jacob get richer, and but this because a blessing of God. God gave him their fair share of inheritance from their father. Now then, whatever God has said to you, do it. So surprisingly, the two wives, Leah and Rachel, they were supporting of their husband Jacob against their father. They felt the father mistreated them, sold them as some sort of commodity, and took the money to himself. Then Jacob went back to his father. While on the way, Rachel unfortunately stole her father's idol, which was made of gold. And they tell us everybody in Jacob's family were worshiping God except Rachel, and she will get punished for that. When Laban figured out that Jacob ran away with his family, he got his sons and his army and chased him and caught up with him after 7 days. However, God appeared to Laban in a dream and warned him, "Don't hurt Jacob by any means." He told him in Genesis 31st, "Be careful that you speak to Jacob neither good nor bad." So when Laban came to Jacob and confronted him, Jacob denied that he stole the idol and promised to kill the thief. Of course, Jacob didn't know that Rachel stole the golden statue. Rachel, on the other hand, hid the idol in the camel saddle and sat on it. So Laban started searching all the tents and all the convoy, couldn't find the statue. When he came to his daughter Rachel, she was sitting on the camel, and she said, "Okay, unfortunately, I can't stand up because I have the period as any other girl." So they couldn't figure out exactly who stole the idol. However, they end up by making a covenant. Jacob took a stone and set it as a pillar and told to his brother, which means told to Laban's son, "Gather more stone." And they took stone and made a heap, and they ate there on the heap. Jacob called this place Gilead or Mizpah. This will become a very important landmark in the life of Samuel, Mizpah. And he said, "This heap will be a witness, and this pillar is a witness, that I will not pass beyond this heap to you, and you will not pass beyond this heap and this pillar to me for harm." So they make a promise, none of them will cross this heap to harm the other, which means Laban will forgive Jacob, and Jacob will forgive Laban. Then here comes the unexpected confrontation between Jacob and Esau. And I'm sure this was in Jacob's mind for many years. So Jacob figured out of a trick that he can do to take away the anger of his brother Esau. He prepared a huge gift, 200 female goats, 20 male goats, 20 ram, 30 camel, and their younger colt, 40 cow, 10 bulls, 20 field donkeys, and 10 foals. So about 300 type of animal. He gave this as a gift to his brother. And he would figure out if he's really giving a gift of 300 animal, then how rich was Jacob? I assume he had at least 10 times this gift. And he sent the gift by the hand of his servant and started to divide his company into three groups. First, he put the two maids and their children. Second, he put Leah and her children. And finally, he put Rachel and her only child at this time, Joseph. And that tell you again that Jacob started to separate between his sons. He didn't really love all of them at the same level. He put the maid first, then Leah, and finally Joseph. And I'm sure this will have a repercussion on the reaction between the sons of Leah and Joseph. They all felt angry that their father favored Joseph over them. And Jacob spent the night praying to God before he meeting Esau. And he told God, "O God of my father Abraham and God of my father Isaac, the Lord who said to me, 'Return to your country and to your family, and I will deal well with you.' I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truths which you have shown me. For I crossed over the Jordan with my staff, and now I became two companies." This is a great verse that someone stay before God that I'm not worthy of the least of all the mercies that you have shown me. Deliver me, I pray, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he come and attack me and the mother with the children. For you said to me, I will surely treat you well and make your descendant as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for the multitude. Genesis 32. And here God appeared to him for the third time in the form of an angel, angel of the Lord. And he kept talking to him all the night. And this is a good example of somebody who wrestled with God in prayer. Not just a quick, short prayer, but a long, long prayer. And he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. So the angel of the Lord said to him, what's your name? Not because he doesn't know his name, but because when I prepare him for the meaning that comes with the new name. So Jacob said, Jacob. And he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have struggled with God with wind, and you have prevailed. So Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. So this is the third time God appeared to him. So now we understand that Israel is basically the same person as Jacob. He only got received this new name after he fought with God. And this we understand. Before, Jacob was following people. He was following his brother Esau. He was following his uncle Laban. He was struggling with them. From now on, he's going to be a follower of God and God only. He's going to give up all this earthly concern and focus his path on following God. That's what the word Israel means. Then it came to meet with his brother Esau. So after he sent all this gift, he ran before all of them and bowed down to him before Esau 7 times. Esau completely forgot all the anger that he had towards Jacob. He hugged him, he kissed him, and they both wept. I'm sure the gift that he sent him, the bowing down that Jacob did, took away all the anger from Esau's heart. And Esau wanted him to go back and live together. However, Jacob wasn't really sure that Esau will keep his word, so he tricked him one more time. He said, oh, my sheep are still young, and I'm afraid I'm following you now. Some of them might die. So let me stay here in this local city for a few months until all the sheep deliver, then I'll follow you and join you back again. And here he make an unnecessary stop at Shechem. Shechem was actually a small town. It was not in the original plan of Jacob. At Shechem, he rested. Then Dinah, his daughter, went out to hang out with the local girls. It's surprising to me that Dinah has 12 brothers or 11 brothers at this time. She went out without any company of any of her brother. She went by herself. And unfortunately, some of the men there, his name is Shechem, he was the son of the city ruler, violated her, raped her, and took her as a hostage in his house. He loved the girl and he went to marry her. So asked her father to go and propose to Jacob. However, Jacob and his son got so angry that that was done to their daughter and they decided to trick him. So Simon and Levi told them, all right, we plan to marry you in one condition, that you circumcise all the males in your village. And they planned this actually not because they plan to marry them, but because they plan to go around and kill them while still suffering in pain. So the son of Jacob came upon the slain, plundered the city because of their sister had been defiled. They took their sheep, their oxen, and their donkeys, and what was in the city and what was in the field, and all their wealth, and the little ones and their wives, they took captive, and they plundered even all that was in the house. Genesis 34. So Now we see the anger of Simon and Levi went far, far beyond what's worth it. So not only they killed Shechem and his father, but killed all the men. And not only killed all the men, but they stole all the valuable items in the village and took them away with them. Of course, that will include a lot of foreign gods, the statue that Jewish people made of gold and worship. And here Jacob decided to go back to Bethel at the first place when God appeared to him in a dream known as Jacob's ladder. And at Bethel, God appeared to him for the fourth time and said, purify yourself, change your garment, and bury all the foreign gods under the tree. Then because of the repentance that Jacob and his family offered, God appeared to him and blessed him and conferred his new name, Israel, and gave him the blessing again, saying, be fruitful and multiply. Kings shall come from your body. Jacob set up a pillar and poured oil and a bloody sacrifice. The terebinth tree actually is a symbol of the cross. And when Jacob told his son to go and bury the foreign god under the terebinth tree, it's like we go and bury our sins under the cross. The blood of the cross, the blood of Jesus Christ, will blot out all our iniquities under the cross. And when Jacob offered an animal sacrifice on an altar at Bethel, it reminds us that atonement can only be obtained by bloody sacrifice at this time. Until Jesus came and he made his own body and blood as a sacrifice, and that took away all the animal sacrifice of the Old Testament. Chapter 31 in the book of Genesis actually end up by two sad events. The first one is Rachel's death. Rachel gave birth to her second son, Benjamin, as Jacob called him Benjamin, which means son of my right hand or son of power. While she died, while she gave birth to this son, she called him Ben-Oni, which means son of my sadness. And she died and was buried shortly before they get to Ephrathah, which is Bethlehem. So she died before they make it to Bethlehem. And we know that Bethlehem will be the city where Jesus will be born. So she died before to get to Bethlehem, before to join Christ and all the new spiritual believer in the New Testament. And that was God's punishment to her. Then she is the one who stole the idol, the one who worshiped idol. So God punished her by dying and buried in a different place. By the way, I would like to mention that all the family of Father Abraham and his sons and wives, they will be buried in one place, in Hebron, in Machpelah grave. Rachel was the only exception, because Rachel's heart was not complete with God. She worshiped idol, she believed in idol, she stole her father's idol, and she wasn't worthy to be buried with the rest of this holy family. The second sad event is Reuben's sin with Bilhah. And it happened that Reuben went and lay with Bilhah, his father's concubine, and Israel heard about it. He didn't really make a decision at this time, but later on, at the end of the book of Genesis, we'll start to give blessing and cursing to his son. He will remember this and he will punish Reuben for it. Then finally, we come to the last event in Isaac's life, which is his death. And Isaac died at age 180, breathed his last, and died was gathered to his people, being old and full of days. And his son Esau and Jacob buried him. Genesis 35, 27 till 29. Of course, we all notice that Isaac overlived his father, Abraham. Abraham lived 175 years, while Isaac lived 180 years. Since Abraham represented the Old Testament, while Isaac represented the life of Jesus Christ. So he died full of days and of great honor. And his both son, Esau and Jacob, buried him. If you look to the marriages of Jacob and his brother Esau, you notice that Esau married at age of 40 to two girls from the Hittite, Judith and Basma. Both were non-Jewish, and both was a grief of mind to Isaac and Rebekah. Jacob also married at the age of 40 to one woman, which is Rebekah. Jacob married his uncle's daughters, Leah and Rachel, and their maids, and he got 12 sons. If we look to Jacob's life in evaluation, he was a man of great desire for blessing. He's a man of prayer, a man of godly vision. God appeared to him at least for now 4 times. A man of godly promises. Every time God appeared to him, he gave him a promise. A man of God. He always worshiped God, never worshiped idol, never worshiped local gods. And when his son stole the idol from the city of Shechem, he asked him to bury them under the tree. Unfortunately, he was a man who achieved success by deceiving others, and in return, he would receive by many. So if you look at Jacob's life in the scale, in terms of blessing, did he receive blessing? Indeed, yes, he received blessing, great blessing. On the other hand, did he enjoy this blessing? Unfortunately, no. What is the reason? The way he lived, deception, trickery, and lying. All these are called unholy ways. And here's a very important spiritual lesson to all of us. If you have a holy goal, then you should pursue them via holy methods. I think we'll stop here because the next lecture is going to be about Joseph and how Jacob favored Joseph and how his brother got anger in him and how later on God used his brother's jealousy to save them and give life to the whole Jewish nation. Thank you for attendance, and I'll see you next week in another episode of the whole Bible series. And glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.